has failed us. And the white liberals who have been posing as our friends have failed us. And once we see that all these other sources to which we've turned have failed, we stop turning to them and turn to ourselves. We need a self-help program.
Alrighty. Hotep, Aquaba, bless up, and greetings, and welcome Black to the recovery room of Racism Non-Anonymous, that revolutionary 12-step self-help program that has been uniquely designed with you and me, the African, in mind. Designed to support our healing and recovering from the shit, traumatic stress of the human intentional type. And I can also reference it as systemic harm and intentional traumatization, SHIT. The same thing, shit. The systemic harm that African descendants, the worldwide, as you're gonna see in a bit, have experienced on this planet. And that is what I am coming here to the recovery room of Racism Not Anonymous. Again, hi, greetings. I am Sis Abena Africa, the recovering African who is culturally enslaved here in America. And I am a representative from the voices in the margins, true to the cause of African liberation via unification and utilizing the tool of healthy and effective communications. I am a traumatized traumatologist, trauma queen, and queen of trauma. And that is understanding trauma and traumatic stress, what it is and how it has and continues to work in the lives of African descendants. And again, I come with this program and with some tools to support you with cleaning up your shit. The shit has been dumped on you, the stress, the trauma that you have experienced in your life, across the generations even, maybe, you know? And there are some tools that are needed for growth and recovery. Yeah, and so that's what I come bringing as a traumatized traumatologist. That's the traumatologist part, you know, that educated, informed, studied, sort of expert in understanding victimization as well as perpetrators. Because if there's been a victim, and I am a victim, I have no qualms with acknowledge and see, I understand in the process of recovery that in order to heal and get better, you know, we have to do something, and we are as sick as our secrets. And I'm in the game of healing and getting better. So if I'm going to do that, I'm going to have to reveal the secret. Yeah, I got. I've been victimized. I'm a fucking victim of this system. Born and reared in it, right? Reared because, you know, some shit was flipped up on me. And people who look like me everywhere we are on the planet, right? And so as I stated, what this meeting, tonight's meeting, is about, topic discussion, and just working to sort of look at and make these connections. This is something that I recognize Some good, yeah, I don't know, 20, 25 years it's been. Good Lord, how long? It's been, good Lord, this is 2024. Yeah, I stopped in the PhD program around in 2004, so a good 20 years ago. And so it's been a good 25 or more years that I have been aware of and learning history of victimization, working as a social worker in with the lower class folks and as a social work student and so forth, and then a PhD student, you get an opportunity to, just make the connections, and you're learning about shit and your research and stuff that's happening. And as I'm looking at this whole thing called colonization, and when that really registered what that was, because I remember a moment, back then, colonization, and I could see that moment and see myself and the folks who were involved, and be able to know now and say in my spirit, I got it now and clearly understand fully colonization. And they talked about that this was in probably the mid-90s, because this was during the time I was an active Black social worker and attending conferences every year. And so this was the 90s, during the whole crack epidemic and so forth, where we did a conference. We, did conferences and things, and the conference and the panelists and so forth, talking about colonization. Now, this is in the 90s, and they were talking about colonization that was going on the continent. And yeah, I suppose even at that time, making the connections between the events of colonization compared to slavery, it's the same thing. It was the same thing. And they just took us from home and brought us over here and did this shit. They went over there. And I mean, for me, I've always looked at it from a perspective of, wow, how much more emotionally, mentally devastating it would have been for them, because they were right still in their own goddamn house. And somebody just come in your house, move you the fuck over, and take over all your shit just like that. And that's exactly what they did. So they did in Kenya. And that's what I wanted to talk about, because I follow a person, Eugene from Kenya. And I think he has another channel. I think I follow two of them, but Eugene from Kenya. And he does many videos. It's sort of like educating Africans on the continent of the experiences of African Americans here. And he does a lot of research. He presents so much information, like awesome. And I am so humbled and grateful and thankful and like, hallelujah, to the stars and gods of all of them, that there seems to be this awakening and awareness, because, in our my experiences with Africans coming here to the States and so forth. And certainly in my life, there was a whole period where, my parents' generation, anyway, in the 60s and 70s and 80s, there was lots of mingling, integration of Africans, Jamaicans, and African American women and stuff that was going on here. At any rate, yeah, my mom married an African. He was from Liberia. And, yet, I've always been aware, just being aware of the similarities between the experience of colonization and our experience as slaves and enslavement here. And as I was saying before, I sort of distracted myself, I believe, distracted myself again. So let me take a slow, deep breath. This is one of the tools of growth, change, healing, one of the tools to get through life's shit. Because when the mind is open and aware and thinking, the spirit is activated based on what it's hearing, what's being triggered. And talking about the experience of oppression, enslavement, racism, for sure opens up, and I'm 64 years old. It opens 64 years of experiences, of stories. It opens up a memory bank that is filled with feelings or memory situations that most certainly will trigger rage. Memories of situations that trigger intense pain. And memories that are definitely connected with the current in terms of the danger, the fear of, holy shit, is this shit ever going to end? Is it ever going, how? Those thoughts, those questions that are associated with the things that we talk about and we're thinking about and we're exploring, right? So it was great to see, and it's been really good to follow on YouTube. And one of the benefits of this World Wide Web is, you know, we're all trapped in this same shit. So we can kind of look and see each other closer because we're all, yeah, collected on this whole web. It is World Wide Web. And as a result, certainly we can see each other and hear each other differently than we could when we couldn't see and hear each other, right? Imagine that, huh? So, as I listened to Eugene, and I became aware because I've been following him for over a year now or so, all of his videos are focused on the experiences of Africans in America. In America, enslaved in American, African American history and shit. And people are now really beginning to hear a lot of things that we have been saying for the past 100 of years, yet, and even just in the past 50 or 60. See, Malcolm's mandate for me, this he said in 1964, I was 4 years old when he said those words. I lived that experience, so I understand what the message is about. And it's something that was programmed in me early on. And you know how they teach in the Bible, raise up a child in the way they should go, and the end thereof they will not depart. And like, that's how that works, see that? Yes. So as I listened to Eugene talk about and focus on the experiences of Africans in America, it like dawned on me, like, I don't hear him talk about what's happening in Kenya. So I want to know more about what happened for Africans on the continent during colonization. And I already have a good sense and awareness in many regards, because of my study and work over the last 30, 35 years, the things that I experienced in life, you know, people I've come across and so forth. Of course, you know, who knows everything? Nobody knows everything. And I want to hear more about from him, you know, tell me about Kenya and how those two are connected. The things that he is exposing to Kenyans and others on the net are experiences that, again, the laws and the brutality. And when I look at what happened in Kenya, it's like it was the same thing. Oh, it was the same flip-flopping thing. And the more interesting, when I did the first old research piece I did here, it gives me a history of Kenya that began with British colonization, which started in 1895. That was the colonial era in Kenya. 1895 to 1963. So I'm 3 years old when this shit ended. And it's in my lifetime. And it's in my lifetime. And first thing that hit me is like, oh, and Africans at that point, that was during our Reconstruction. I guess it was 1895, and then it was Reconstruction here. Reconstruction over here and over there on the continent. What was going on is the British were now Queen Elizabeth and company went over to the African continent and colonized. Now I need to think about and look at the date of what was it called? Oh, sugar. When they all sat down and divided Africa up. There's a term for it. It's not coming to me just at the moment. However, within the context of, this time frame for Kenya and this initial research in terms of what happened in Kenya, their colonial era started 30 years after Africans had been quote unquote freed here in America, and we were dealing with colonization and Jim Crow. What they were dealing with over in Kenya was British colonization. And what the Brits did, in fact, was simply just what I said. You go into somebody's house, they just came and move in their damn house, push their asses off into the corner. It's like tie them up in a corner, strip them of everything that they had on, strip them naked, tie them up in a fucking corner in their house, and then took over. Claimed all that shit is theirs, rearranged it, set it up the way they wanted it, invited all their friends and shit, and grew. And I suppose, threw you bones and left you to figure out how to get out of that shit and get out of that little corner we got your ass buried in, and dig your way a tunnel out of there to do something, because this is now mine and you just get out of here. And that was colonization. Bottom line, in a nutshell. This is just about Kenya. And how many. I've never been good with history kind of shit. The continent of Africa has how many nations or countries? Kenya's a considered, okay, Ghana, Kenya, West Africa, South Africa, they're considered what? I don't know, countries. They're not states. In the United States, we have states over there. They have what? Colonies or whatever, however you call it. At any rate, this is just Kenya. There are however many more locations across the continent where this same thing happened. And I also know that shit took place way before 1895. I've been a researcher. I'm a researcher by nature. I'm always curious. I was always the one asking questions. I was always the one with a book in my hand growing up. So, I'm very inquisitive. I want to know. Spiritually, I'm a seer and I'm a truth-sayer. And it's like, oh, okay. And in order to say some shit and say the truth, you have to ask her some questions, just do some research, just study. You just don't say shit out of shit, you know. So that's where I come from. Yet, yes, land alienation. Then they had racism and segregation during that period where they set up the same hierarchical system that we have established here, that they have, excuse my French or something, that they have established here that we live with and we live up under. Because, like I said, I'm culturally enslaved. I have no option, no choice if I want to continue to live. And unless and until I gain the necessary tools and resources to do some shit different, ain't damn thing I can do except for when in Rome, do as the Romans, so to speak. Like, oh, okay, that's what that meant, and that's where that shit came from. Like, oh, I see, said the blind man. They imposed strict racial hierarchy. They were at the top, followed by the Asians, and then, of course, Africans were located at the bottom. And this was particularly, they said, yeah, laws and policies segregated the races, particularly in urban settings like Nairobi. And that was Nairobi. I had a video. It told a story of a child in a Kikuyu. The name will come back to me probably in the next maybe 24, 36 hours, and maybe I will locate that video. It was a DVD. Child's video tells a story of this child in Kenya. Kikuyu, somebody like that. Nairobi, however. Yeah. It just triggered that memory again. Africans were largely excluded from political participation. Political, oh, imagine that. Like, just like we couldn't vote, we had to fight for voting rights. They were excluded from political participation in their own home. Now, just that dynamic in and of itself, for me, is just mind blowing. Our brains, it is true. If our brains is a computer and functions like a computer, major computer system, every time I say this shit and think about it, it's like I blow several fuses for a bit and they regenerate themselves and come back. Yet, when you're in shock, it's like, and that's what it's like. For me, being the spirit, the empath, the seer that I am, when I'm talking about it spiritually, I could step into it and I'm in it. My spirit is there, and it's like, like how egregious a thing to experience. Can you imagine? And if we really like step back and look at what the fuck happened, that's exactly what happened for them. That's what they had to live with. And yes, we live with the shit we live with, having been taken away and put in some old foreign shit now. We like, what the fuck? And we have all this shit to learn and assimilate to, and in the fight for, and what, and this has been going on for African people all over, no matter where we are. The ones they took, they dropped some of us off here out in the fucking Caribbean, all them different Caribbean, the South America, all North, all parts of fuck. And shit's still going on, and it's still happening. So that's why, yeah, when I introduce myself and it's like being the queen of trauma, it's like I'm talking about what happened and what and how it's still working. And traumatic stress, how it works in our bodies, mind, body, and spirit, and why breathing is the first tool to learn to master, to understand, to get in touch with your breath, your spirit, you, yourself. Because the impact, the connection, we had like a system malfunction for a moment because it's like a major fucking glitch up in there in the mind and the spirit working to reconcile this information that it's working to process and settle back down. It was settled for a minute and then it kicked up again, like as I was getting ready to try to finish some point I think I was about to make. Yeah. So there were early resistant movements in beginning, and that's the thing. Well, it's interesting. Well, the 63, and that's about the time for revolution kicked up for African folks across everywhere we are. So again, that's what I was, everywhere we are, everywhere we've been dropped off and victimized and brutalized and terrorized and traumatized. And it's like, damn, same old story, same old song. You know what? You know who I want to share right now as we take a kind of musical break? One of the tools in recovery and in the program of recovery, 12 steps, addiction science, and in the recovery field, music therapy is also a tool. Not so much, interestingly enough, it wasn't then where I was located, when I was located there, I'll put it like that. And my experience in the mental health field, working at an agency where, we had their two programs, the drug and alcohol and the mental health, as if they're different. However, they were separate because funding sources were separate. Yet we were all located on the same floor and we interacted, so to speak, in some ways. And there came an opportunity for music therapy to be offered for clients, this new program, it was free, it had all these things, and there's all this rationale why it was good tool for clients. And I'm like, cool, I'm in the DNA side. Most of the other folks was, it was just two of us, three drug and alcohol therapists and about four or five mental health therapists. And what it came out to was that the program was not offered for the drug and alcohol clients, as if that wasn't appropriate for them. They're the most traumatized, or just as traumatized as the mental health people. Yet the mental health people just didn't use drugs and alcohol to manage their shit. They had other addictions. That's all that was. Yet that's how the system is. Yet that's a whole nother thing. At any rate, so they did not offer the music therapy to my client population, addicts, drug addicts, quote unquote. And thunderstorm is what we're looking for. Yeah, we're coming like a thunderstorm, she said. And that really, that was just wrong. Music therapy is most definitely appropriate for us, for folks who's experienced significant trauma, people who have struggled with and or have family members who have struggled with substance abuse and addiction, alcohol, crack cocaine, heroin, pills, and other stuff, other forms of addiction, and even folks who have had parents or family members and or themselves who struggle with overeating, working, gambling, shopping, and or other energy boosting shit, skydiving, what do you call those type of stimulating events that people sort of become hooked on, and that becomes their out and or their go-to in a way where it is also doing some harm that's not being attended to. And or, it's covering up something that's not being attended to. That's how people we use shit. And it's about how to do it. So we're gonna take a really quick break because this energy that Queen Omega brings in here is just off the chain. And when I really heard the words again today, it's like, oh, I got to listen to me some more and get much more familiar with the sister's message and her music. So check this out. She say now I'm just praying and hoping that the music is permissible on the YouTube platform. I know that I can play Maccabee is copywritten, however it's allowed, so I would like to know that the sister's music is also copywritten, yet I most certainly want to introduce you to it, and I want you to go check her out and check out more of her music as I have been doing. And I did that for the first time today, and I'm not sure, I forget the name of the CD track or album that I listened to. Yet it's like, ooh, off the hook. I know many other of Queen Omega's tunes. However, I never really got into all her tunes and just really immersed myself in some Queen Omega to the point where I will begin to know the words on all her tracks, and she's spitting it like raw, that she's speaking for me. Speaking for me, and if she's speaking for me, that means she's speaking for we. Me, Mama Earth, we wise energies, African folks, melanated folks, the original folks on the planet, right? And so, yeah, and it's our time. That's what I see. It's that time. It's another major shift in time and shit. It's how the world works, huh? And it most certainly is time where shit is being exposed, and it's time to address some of the shit. We'll address it while it's here. I'm not sure how long this change gonna last and where it's going yet. I know I have my cues and my spirit where it's tuned into, where my energy is focused on. And I don't believe that I am alone. And that's a good thing to know. So yes, we're coming like a thunderstorm. She's an awesome, adorable, pretty, very pretty sister. And I look at her and I see myself, I see my mom, my aunts, and, black women. Beauty, the beauty, this beautiful. That's what I see, beauty. So, yeah, I'm not sure what else can I talk about. Do I want to talk about? It was in the 60s, the early 60s, where there was a major movement again for Africans across the world. Everywhere we were, there was a major revolutionary period. And yeah, that's another piece of research that I did peep sometime at some point. Looking at the history patterns and research as a PhD student, the research is research, so. Every 60 years, though, it's like a 60-year cycle where there is a major change and shift on the world stage. 60 years ago, there was, for African descendants, the shift that happened for us was an awakening all over, where there was revolution and there was demands and fights for independence, which we all gained to greater or lesser extent. Right? So we said both and dynamic. We got some shit and we lost a whole lot of shit at the same time because some other shit still happened. And now we're 60 years later and now we can recognize what shit happened. Now we're getting ready to clean that shit up. Yeah. And maybe another 60 years before, the next really phase uncovers itself, whereby we will have the things that we've been fighting for. Liberation and freedom to be, to exist, and freedom from tyranny, freedom from somebody's sickness, somebody else's mental illness, their sick way of thinking and behaving in the world. Africans, everywhere we are on the continent, have given and given and given. And this is what Europeans or white folks, you've done with it, taking it and twisted it and threw it in our face. It threw this shit right back in our face in a way. It's like, and you behave like an animal, just like a damn dog. Dogs take something and they take something, a bone. You give them a good thing, you give them a bone, and what do? They take that shit, turn around and stick their ass up to you and dig a hole and bury that shit. And see why they digging that hole? They digging that hole and all that mud and shit hitting you. Why they take that good thing you gave them and bury it, cover it up while covering you with shit. That's what they did to us. That's how I see it. That's how I see it. Everywhere we are and have been, and it seems, I'm just saying, I know you all didn't start this shit just with us. Y'all been doing that to yourselves first. Fighting in your own internal fights and shit. And then as you all branched off and then you claim this and now you found a way to unite all against us. Let's bring us all together. Because as I understand it, a whole lot of white people didn't know they were white until somebody put that shit out and spread the word. We're white people now. We can all unite, whether you're Polish, Italian. Yeah, because the way they treated the Polish and the way they treated every other group that came to America as immigrants and migrants and all that shit. And yes, Russia, all of you have been abused and all of you mofos impose your shit on us in the process. And it wasn't until whoever the white folks decided, hey, let's just all be white. And that way, y'all poor folks won't unite. Yeah. Y'all poor folks, the poor folks was black and white. The Polish, all of them were poor. And that way, you can stop y'all from getting together and uniting, right? We all white. So now they clean up the Polish and the Italian, the Irish, and all of them get together and they start working together and they work out their white. And let's put this on top. And that's what became this thing called white supremacy. And you just begin to teach that shit and enculturate all of us into that way of thinking. Not just black folks, though, your own people. And they are beginning to recognize that now. As well, it covers is being pulled back all over the place. And on every seemingly level of lived experience is thus far as well. So far, entertainment, wide open. What are the other areas? Education. That has been exposed and open, the shit they've been doing in the education system. And how they have been jacking up our children and returning them to active little slaves, undereducating, miseducating, what they have done to our children in the last 30 years is just atrocious. I'm so sorry and sad, and I was part of witnessing this shit and being extremely in a position of very relative no power because the adults were cracked up. And what were happening to the children during that generation and what I've seen and witnessed and worked to, you know, do what I could do in the place that I was at. Just devastating. And people didn't want to hear shit. It was on cracked up. The education system, education law. Is that one of the areas of lived experience, is it, or nine areas that Nellie Fuller talks about? At any rate, yeah, politics and all that. So, what can we say? You know, when I'm talking about RNA, racism not anonymous, because racism and the lies of African descendants, Africans everywhere. I'm a woman of African descent. My ancestors were enslaved here in America, and all that we are, I am. I am Rasta, Christian. I identify. I understand. It is a takeaways. There's connections. I led my family into the Christian church. They haven't followed me out yet. Yet. They're secure where they are. Islam, Muslim, yeah, there's the connections. Brother Malcolm, I'm a Brother Malcolm type Muslim. I'm with that Muslim energy, that Islamic energy and message and understanding and teaching and shit. Yeah. Yeah. So I don't know. There's not much else I'm gonna say right now, since right now I'm not live. I'm in my Zoom room anyway, and however I haven't invited anyone. No one has the link. No one knows I'm here. So I'm really just doing this to post this for you guys here on YouTube and my YouTube folks. It's been a whole long time, over 10 years since I've been here, and I'm coming back, and I'm going to just keep coming. As we talk about and teach in the realms of recovery, we say, keep coming back. It works when you work it. And this is what we're gonna end with for tonight. Another signature tune that what the program is all about. It's about having a safe space here in the room of Racism Not Anonymous, a safe space to talk about racism, how it affects us, how it, and what are some of the things that people can do, are doing, sharing our experience, strength, and plans for how to get up out of this shit. That's what we do. So I would say to you, thanks for listening to me share. Drop a comment and let's keep the lines of communication open. Peace.
Well, some people like to dismiss slavery like it was nothing. But you see, slavery, it can never be forgotten. Some people not gonna like what I say, but me, I gonna say it anyway. We are gonna talk about slavery and the effects of it today. Some people just don't want to know about 400 years ago. But the thing about slavery, it's affecting people now. I tell you no lie, when I see a film about slavery, water comes to my eye. You want to know why? Because it was me. I'm the same black man hanging in that tree, you see. They couldn't control my soul, so they had to control my body mysteriously. I and I has returned as the big Rasta man, Maccabee. See, what about all the life that were lost? What about the black Holocaust? What about African slavery and what it's done to you and me? What about all the blood that was shed? What about the innocent dead? What about when the ship overload and it threw them overboard? Oh, I can see the effects of slavery still in the community, no identity. Suffering from amnesia, a case of lost memory, black man and woman. Can't you see your history never start on the plantation? Original man, man of creation, father of all nation. Just stay strong. Let go the brainwash mentality, no go on like no Babylonian. The road is long. You're gonna meet a lot of obstacles, no bow to the temptation. Run, see your time. Tell the boy to go away. You're not in a nothing with him plan. Hold up your hand to the Almighty One. You are part of a great nation, man. What about all the mothers that cried? What about all the children that died? What about all the suicide and the pain we feel inside? What about all the shackles and chain? What about the messing up of the brain? Don't know from where you came, you don't even know your name. Aided and abetted by some unscrupulous African. 100 million is the estimation that died on the crossing or the plantation with no compensation. Holocaust is a word that they use for what the Nazis did to the Jews. Compensation was never refused. Their own land they even got to choose. So what's wrong with us? Was the black Holocaust not so serious? What's wrong with us? Was the black Holocaust not so serious? What's wrong with us? Was the black Holocaust not so serious? What's wrong with us? Is the black Holocaust not so serious? Some people not gonna like what me say, but me I gonna say it anyway. We are gonna talk about slavery and the effects of it today. Some people just don't want to know about 400 years ago. But the thing about slavery, it's affecting people now. What about all the lives that were lost? What about the black Holocaust? What about African slavery and what it's done to you and me? What about all the blood that was shed? What about the innocent dead? What about when the ship overload and it threw them overboard? What about all the mothers that cried? What about all the children that died? What about all the suicide and the pain we feel inside? What about all the shackles and chain? What about the messing up of the brain? Don't know from where you came, you don't even know your name. You don't know from where you came, you don't even know your name.
You don't know from where you came, you don't even know your name. Rastafari.